The testimony of our Maker's word tells us that when he renews his covenant at the end of this era of time with the scattered descendants of Israel, he is going to put his straight and narrow pathway in our inward parts and write it upon our hearts. He told us this through his servant Jeremiah in chapter 31. In light of this no-brainer of all no-brainers, how any of you can make the claim that you are already in his new covenant defies basic principles of logic. If he has put his straight and narrow pathway in your inward parts and written it upon your hearts, why is it that all of you live in utter rebellion to his straight and narrow pathway? Why did he tell us things like that his servant Satan has deceived all of the world at the end of this era of time? He did so as part of his Emmanuel man-child, Mahershala Kushbaz prophecy. Why did he cause his servants, the prophets, to tell us that he is going to send his hot indignation upon those of you that do not do his righteous judgments, and those of you that despise his boundaries, and those of you that profane his Sabbaths, and those of you that do not put a difference between the clean and the unclean, etc., at the end of this era of time? Do you realize that you have to reject the entire testimony of his inspired word in order to believe into the doctrines of the abomination that desolated his word, Saul of Tarsus? The abomination that now is desolating his house through your dual feet? You have to twist and pervert all of his inspired word in order to do so, just like Satan's boy, Saul of Tarsus, did. You even have to reject that which his only begotten son spoke, as recorded by the eyewitnesses Matthew and John. His only begotten son clearly spoke that we are to live by every single word that his father sent forth from his mouth. He clearly spoke things like, unless our righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, we will in no way enter Tekihwe's kingdom, his eternal realm. He told us that we are here in the flesh in order to become perfect or without blemish, like our Father that is in his dual heavens is without blemish. If Yahweh is your Father, you would obviously obey him, unless, of course, you are of the rebellious house of Israel that usually don't even obey your earthly parents. And what do you do with the rest of his Jeremiah chapter 31, renewing of his covenant prophecy? Like him telling us that he is going to set up Zion's to mark his highway out from the captivity of Mystery Babylon at this time, and that he's going to place harsh bitternesses in your pathway to cause you to turn back to him, etc. What do you do with him telling us in this prophecy that he is going to sow this new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, with the seed of an Adam and with the seed of a beast? What do you do with him telling us that he is going to do a new thing at the time that he cuts this covenant in causing a female to revolve around a valiant man? I will tell you what you do with these things. You do like you do with the rest of the testimony of his word that is written upon the here and the now. You either dismiss them altogether, or you twist and pervert them into your twisted, warped perversions of his word that you learned from your boy Saul of Tarsus, the abomination that desolated his word, that is now desolating his set-apart house, his holy place, through your dual feet. And you reject the no-brainer reality of things like this new covenant, including him telling us that his doing so is going to include him writing his straight and narrow pathway upon our hearts and putting it in our inward parts. These things, O Israel, are absolutely no-brainers. The fact that you cannot be in his renewed covenant that he has cut at this time is the no-brainer of all no-brainers, that you are deceived.